Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran tells us clearly to always be mindful of Allah and say the word of truth. Allah says, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu ittaqullaha wa qulu qawlan sadida. And this results in يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. So that Allah will rectify your deeds and forgive your sins. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. And whosoever obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will indeed get a great reward. And in fact, this ayah puts us into today's khutbah and the question, do we do what we do because Allah said so or because the community said so? There's a famous saying that we hear nowadays, which is to live and let live. Mind your own business. Stay in your lane. And these have implications that are correct Islamically and some implications that are incorrect in Islam. So let's try to analyze this word, mind your own business. How does Islam agree or disagree with this statement? So you know, many scenarios happen around us that invite us, even according to the liberal, liberal culture, that we don't mind our own business. So a young man is bullied at school, and you see classmates or even teachers bullying a person. This society, the American culture, tells you to speak up, and they don't tell you to mind your own business. A wife gets abused by her husband. We don't say mind your own business, right? We say speak up. A crime happening in front of our eyes, somebody breaking into your neighbor's car. You don't mind your own business, you go and call the police. And similarly, in Islam, it teaches us if somebody is slipping off their deen, their Islam, they stop coming to the masjid. They started showing signs that they are not interested in this commitment to Islam anymore. In Islam, we don't mind our own business. We try to give nasiha to that person. If a dear community member started going the path of drugs and alcohol and substance abuse, we don't mind our own business. We try to go and help that person. If a girl or a guy is behaving immodestly, modesty is not only for girls or for Muslim women, it's for everyone. We don't mind our own business. We try to go and rectify the situation. بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ. With wisdom and the best of speech. But the idea is, we don't ignore what's happening. If a parent is exposing their children to apps and social media and a phone in general that they're not supposed to have, they're too young for this. As a Muslim, I'm not supposed to mind my own business. I'm supposed to go and warn. There's this website, Wait Until 8th. Wait until 8th grade. So they're advising parents, please don't give a child a phone before they get into 8th grade. Because yes, they may have some good uses for it, but they may have a lot of bad uses for it. My policy in my home, not until college. I don't think a young person should get a phone. But that's another discussion. So Islam doesn't tell us to mind our own business. Because other people's iman and safety and security is for the whole community. And this takes us to the hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that is narrated by Al-Bukhari, where An-Nu'man ibn Bashir says, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave an analogy for the community. And how does the community react when it comes to obeying or breaking the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I want everybody to take very close attention to this hadith. Because this hadith is talking about my family and your family. This hadith talks about our schools, our workplace, about all of us. مثل القائم على حدود الله والواقع فيها كمثل قوم استهموا على سفينة فصار بعضهم أعلاها وبعضهم أسفلها. So the analogy of people when it comes to them obeying or disobeying or breaking the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala It's like a community who boarded a ship, a huge boat, and because it is huge, some of them had to go to the upper deck, and the others had to go to the lower deck. And they could not, you know, facilitate who's going to go up, who's going to go down. So let us draw lots. And some of them had the privilege to go upstairs, and the others had to go downstairs. وَكَانَ الَّذِينَ فِي أَسْفَلِهَا إِذَا اسْتَقَوْا مِنَ الْمَاءِ مَرَّوْا مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ مَرَّوْا مِنْ عَلَى فَوْقِهِمْ So those in the lower deck, whenever they wanted to go and seek water, they had to bother those on the top. Let me disturb you, please. Excuse me. They had to make their way up and in order to go on that top level and then bring their bucket to get that, you know, water and drink for themselves and for their families. So they started thinking. They started thinking outside the box. They started getting creative. Why don't we do something different? Who caused these laws that I have to go up and bring that bucket down? Who said this? Who said that? Why there are restrictions? Why can't I do my own thing? Why can't my freedom of expression, why can't everyone, you know, approve me to do whatever I want? So they said, فَقَالُوا لَوْ أَنَّا خَلَقْنَا فِي نَصِيبِنَا خَرْقًا وَلَمْ نُقْضِ مَنْ فَوْقَنَا Why don't we poke a hole into the ship? It's our part, not their part. It's my business, my personal life. Please, nobody interfere with my personal life. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us, he's not talking to those on the lower deck. Those on the lower deck, they don't see the big picture. Those on the lower deck, they may not know the implications of their decision. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is talking to those on the upper deck. فَإِنْ أَمْسَكُوا عَلَىٰ أَيْدِيهِمْ نَجَوْا وَنَجَوْا جَمِيعًا If they hold on to their hands, if they stop them from poking a hole into the ship of society, all of them will be saved. وَإِنْ تَرَكُوهُمْ And they say, it's not our business. Live and let live. It's not our part. Let's make sure that our iman is okay. Let me make sure that I pray, I fast, I don't disobey, I'll be alone, I'll be safe. So the Prophet Muhammad is telling us, those on the lower deck, on the upper part of the ship, if you leave them, if you leave evil people to drive and poke holes into the ship, then all of us will drown. وَإِن تَرَكُوهُمْ نَجَوْا وَنَجَوْا جَمِيعًا Prophet Muhammad is telling us that sometimes minding our own business is very detrimental. It will cause all the ship of society to sink. And we have seen COVID. We've been living, this is our second year into the pandemic. And we've seen that one person who carries the virus might infect a whole society. If they choose not to wear a mask, if they choose not to get vaccinated, if they choose just to, you know, go by their life, they may affect a whole community, and an innocent person might get that virus, subhanAllah. We've seen the effects of passive smoking. When someone is sitting in the company of another person who is smoking, how it affects their health. So we are seeing this in the physical world, how the sins of others might affect the whole. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us that minding your own business is not an Islamic concept in many cases. Where are the situations where you really have to mind your own business? Where in Islam it tells you, don't interfere with others. Don't get into other people's private lives. Don't spy on others and tell them, yeah, I'm making sure that they pray on time. No, Islam does not tell you you can spy on others. You cannot judge one's destination whether they go to Jannah or Hellfire. You cannot say, if somebody is committing a sin, this does not, and you happen to know more, you happen to be on the upper deck of the ship of society, you don't go and tell them, oh, this person is going to Jannah, this person is going to hellfire. Actually, the hadith Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as narrated Imam Muslim, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come to such person on the day of judgment, and he will ask, من ذا الذي يتألى على الله? Who is that person who claims to play the role of God? And judge that such a person will go to hellfire. And this is a sin by itself to judge someone's final destination, but you should give nasiha. Rebuking and insulting a sinner, when somebody makes fun of a sinner, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his time, a man who was an alcoholic, who drank alcohol a lot, and he used to do this in public. So he used to be brought to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and as the head of the state, and as the one who should enforce the law, he would punish him. So the Sahaba who would watch his punishment, they started insulting him. Yes, as the head of a state, you should punish those who break the law. But you cannot insult a sinner. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. And the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ told the Sahaba, لَا تَكُونُوا عَوْنًا لِلشَّيْطَانِ عَلَىٰ أَخِيكُمْ. Do not help the shaytan over your brother. And then he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because this man loves Allah and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahu Akbar. He got a testimony from the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that this man who's addicted to alcohol has deep love in his heart for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger. So you never support the shaytan over your brother. You give nasiha, but without insulting. You cannot mind your own business. You cannot find and search for faults in others. Go look to their profile. Go try to hack into their device to see if they are doing right or wrong. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he advised us, من تتبع عورة أخيه تتبع الله عورته. Those who try to search for faults in others, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will expose their faults. Because this is not nasiha. And finally, don't look up into people's past. If somebody used to cross the limits of Allah, they had a past, but they became better. Don't try to dig up their past just because you want to prove a point. أستر أستر من ستر مسلما ستره الله في الدنيا والآخرة. But again, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us, when a sin is exposed in public, when people normalize certain activities, when people start claiming that such and such sin or such and such act is normal, it's okay, we should accept whoever is doing it. No. This is poking a hole into the ship of humanity, and the whole society will be affected. So brothers and sisters, whatever that sin is, whatever that injustice is, if an injustice is happening, you know, in another city, for another community, for people with a different race or ethnicity, and I say it's not happening to me, this injustice did not afflict me or my family, I tell you no. In Islam, it's telling us that we are all in the same ship, subhanAllah. And that's why there's a warning from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I conclude with this hadith, inshallah ta'ala, warning for five traits, five incidents. If they happen, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is giving us a prophecy. He is warning us, hey Muslims, watch out. And wallahi, this hadith is one of the proofs of the multiple proofs we have that the man who is saying these words is a messenger from Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wallahi, whenever I read or hear this hadith, subhanAllah. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِنَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. Look at this hadith narrated by Ibn Majah. يَا مَعْشَرَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ. O companions who migrated from Mecca to Medina. خَمْسٌ إِذَا ابْتُلِيتُمْ بِهِنَّ وَأَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ أَنْ تُدْرِكُوهُنَّ. There are five traits, five calamities. I seek refuge in Allah from you witnessing any of them. Number one. لم تظهر الفاحشة في قوم قط حتى يعملوا بها. Whenever the sin of adultery and fornication gets revealed and is committed publicly, and then people don't mind it anymore. إلا فشى فيهم الطاعون والأوجاع التي لم تكن في أسلافهم الذين مضوا. Whenever the sins of adultery and fornication become exposed, become public, it's not happening behind closed doors anymore. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not talking or warning about committing zina. It's about publicizing zina. And we all know what happens online. We all know what happens, you know, with many websites, with many ways that zina is being, you know, communicated to all of us, to the youth, to the young, and the adults. So the Prophet said, plagues and diseases that were not known before in previous communities will be abundant, will be prevailing, will prevail, subhanAllah. That's warning number one. Sadaqa Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We're seeing it, right? Number two, وَلَمْ يُنْقِسُ الْمِكْيَالَ وَالْمِيزَانِ. Whenever the business people cheat in their measures and weights, إِلَّا أُخِذُوا بِالسِّنِينِ وَشِدَّةِ الْمَأُونَةِ وَجَوْرِ السُّلْطَانِ عَلَيْهِمْ. Those who cheat in their weights, those who cheat in their business, those who try to slip, you know, to cheat the system, whether it's a food stamp, yes, let me sell tobacco instead of a food stamp or whatever. Any cheating in business, أُخِذُوا بِالسِّنِينِ, they will be afflicted with the years of poverty, like the years of Yusuf, and the lack of basic needs and extreme injustice from those in power. So the first one was warning us from our mannerism going down because of adultery and fornication. Second one, talking about business. Number three, وَلَمْ يَمْنَعُوا زَكَاةَ أَمْوَالِهِمْ. Whenever the rich start holding on to the zakah money, and they don't give it to those who are due, to those who need it. إِلَّا مُنِعُوا الْقُطْرَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. They will be stopped from getting the rain from the skies. But we still get some rain, right? Imagine how many rich people we have in the Muslim world. Imagine if every rich person gained the 2.5% of their zakah. We will never get a single poor person or community or country. But the Prophet ﷺ tells us, وَلَوْلَا الْبَهَائِمُ لَمْ يُمْطَرُوا. Were it not for those poor animals that live around us, the cats and the sheep and the cows and the dogs, were it not for those animals that are living around us, we will never get a single droplet of rain, subhanAllah. So Allah is saving us with rain year after year just because of the animals, not because of the people, when we stop giving the zakat of our money. وَلَمْ يَنْقُضُوا عَهْدَ اللَّهِ وَعَهْدَ رَسُولِهِ. When people break the oath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِلَّا خَلَّطَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ عَدُوًا مِنْ غَيْرِهِمْ فَأَخَذُوا بَعْضَ مَا فِي أَيْدِيهِمْ. Allah will allow their enemies to overcome them and overtake them. And that last warning from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I want us to reflect on these prophecies from him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا لَمْ تَحْكُمْ أَئِمَّتُهُمْ بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَيَتَخَيَّرُ مِمَّا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ بَأْسَهُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ. And when their leaders and governors do not rule by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will start to cause conflict and divisions to separate them. And that's exactly what we see in the Muslim world and in the whole world, subhanAllah. Going back to the basics, in Islam, we mind our own business until and unless there is something that deals with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained, then at that point we have to change the munkar and the evil. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ عَظِيمِهِ وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ فَيَا فَوْزَ الْمُسْتَغْفِرِينَ. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Many of us feel embarrassed to speak up when an injustice is happening. Many of us feel that, oh, I have to be insulted, I have to be humiliated, it's outside of my comfort zone. And it is hard, subhanAllah. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is warning us that let's have some courage to step up. And, you know, when somebody breaks the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have a say, we have a position. We try to advise, but wallahi bil hikmah, notice that the Prophet ﷺ is telling us that you, as a righteous person, and the sinner, you are in the same ship. You should realize that if a hole is whole, all of us will drown. So once you have this humility, once you have this empathy, once you have this love for the person who's sinning, you tell them, yeah, actually, my kids will be exposed to the same, you know, situation. My kids might get into the similar, you know, situation that you are going through. Once we have this love, I feel that sometimes religious people may not have the right amount of love for the sinner. People think that we are judging them. People think that we are talking to them from a pedestal. And wallahi, nasiha is not about giving a khutbah. The true nasiha is when we are together in the gym or in the school or at work, and we try to give nasiha out of love. Look at Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, how he gave nasiha, beautiful nasiha to his dad. Ya abati, inni qad ja'ani min al-'ilmi ma lam ya'tik. Dad, I got some knowledge that you didn't get. He did not tell him, I am a prophet and you are not. He didn't tell him, God spoke to me and not to you. He didn't tell him, I know better than you. I got some knowledge, although Ibrahim got a lot of knowledge. Inni qad ja'ani min al-'ilmi ma lam ya'tik. Sometimes it's hard, especially for our young ones, to advise somebody who is older and who might be committing a mistake or a sin, who might be smoking, who might be chewing drugs or whatever. It's hard. So try to use the best speech. إِنِّي قَدْ جَاءَنِي مِنَ الْعِلْمِ مَا لَمْ يَكْتِبْ فَاتَّبِعْنِي أَهْدِكَ صِرَاطًا صَوِيًّا. So follow me. But he still gave the advice. He gave the nasiha. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to the best of speeches and the best of intentions when we give nasiha. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to empower us to say the word of truth. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help all of us protect the ship of humanity. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help all of us fulfill the fariqah of al-amr bil-ma'roof wal-nahi al-munkar, enjoying the good and forbidding the evil. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless this community and to bless this masjid and to help all of us uphold to the amana that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given us. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa thabbit aqdamana wansurna ala alqawm alkafirin. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika an nadhilla aw nudhal aw nazilla aw nuzal aw nadhlima aw nudhlam aw najhala aw yujhal alayna. اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا وأصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي إليها معادنا واجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر. اللهم تب علينا لنتوب اللهم تب علينا لنتوب اللهم تب علينا لنتوب. اللهم لا تدع لنا في هذا المقام العظيم ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا قضيته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا شابا ضالا إلا هديته ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا والآخرة هي لك رضا ولنا فيها صلاح إلا أعنتنا على قضائها ويسرتها لنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر.